My second and the last lecture on atomic clock and fundamental physics. So in the second lecture, as I already told you yesterday I introduced about the atomic clocks, its different type of clocks and their principles. And today I'm going to talk about the fundamental science that can be probed using such kind of highly precise atomic clocks. And to give you examples, like for example, the quantum communication, that's a boom right now. Like all the developed countries are, let's say, demonstrating or developing the quantum technologies, quantum communications, and so on, including India. India is also trying to develop that. And geodesy, like geodetic measurements, constancy of the fundamental symmetries, like different kind of symmetries are there in our standard model. So whether those symmetries are really symmetry or they violates. Similarly, constancy of different fundamental constants, dimensionless fundamental constants, like let's say fine structure constants, electron to proton mass ratio, capital G, and so on, so on. So whether this is really a constant or it's very varying with time. So those kind of things can be probed using very accurate, highly accurate atomic clocks, particularly the optical clocks. So yeah, I'm not able to change this slide. Ah, yeah, right now. Okay. So so this is the last slide. I mean, from yesterday's talk. So if you remember, so the y-axis is 1 second inaccuracy over some certain duration when some clock actually operates or runs. And as I told you yesterday, that the most accurate clocks are at present accurate to 1 second over, let's say, 30 billion years, 33 billion years, on that order. So the question was like, why do we need that? And the applications, they are really required. They have applications in science as well as technology. And today I shall focus on the scientific part, their applications on the scientific part. But before I go to the scientific part, just one slide on technological applications. And this is this one. So you can basically list all kind of advanced technologies, and they require very highly precise time synchronization and time stamping. To name few of them, for example, navigation. Most of us use the Google Map kind of things or some online map things. They require very precise time synchronization among the clocks, and the kind of requirement is, let's say, few tens of nanosecond. So it's really, really very accurate clocks are required to get them functioning. Similarly, communication, like any 4G communications we are using at present, and 5G will be there within a short amount of time. So they require very accurate time synchronization and time stamping. Surveillance also in defense applications or any other strategic applications. Long range accurate targeting, like if you want to send a missile, you want that missile to be targeted to a particular target rather than falling it anywhere else. So that requires, that's basically again coming back to navigation, and it requires very accurate clocks. Like in our daily life, we use electronic transactions or digital archiving, they require very accurate clocks. Weather forecasting, like there is a cyclone and where exactly it will hit, that can be only predicted not only by good models, meteorological models, but it requires very accurate time synchronization to predict where actually it will hit within an accuracy of, let's say, within few kilometers and so on. And it's very important. We have seen it in last few weeks, like in India, there are two hits by two cyclones, and it was very accurately predicted, and it's possible by both like satellite technologies, good models, as well as good clocks, which are backbone of all these things. So I will not go into detail of these technological applications today, but I would rather focus on the scientific part. So over, let's say, last 100 years, there are different kind of clocks. It has improved by several orders of magnitude, like starting from pendulum clocks. Now we have the optical clock, and those things, last three things we have discussed yesterday. So one of the application of this kind of accurate clocks is accurate timekeeping. So, which is like maintaining a time with very accurately, like for example, in India, it's Indian Standard Time and so on. And why it is required? Because then, I mean, for any country, for the for any advancement, let's say the worldwide trading and etc., time plays a major role. Like for example, if someone wants to book a like this stock exchange things, it's an international thing. If your time is not synchronized in the stock exchange by, let's say, few tens of nanosecond, there will be huge loss. We don't understand those things, but that really plays a major role in for time synchronization in all those areas. So maintaining for any country, maintaining its standard of time with respect to the international standard is very, very important for the advancement of the country. So that is one aspect, maintaining standard of time and its application in sophisticated technologies, as I discussed. And there generally cesium fountain clocks are, I mean, so far it's quite good. So the typical accuracy, the best accuracy of the cesium clocks are on the order of 10 to the power minus 16. And in this plot, what you see, the x-axis is year and y-axis is accuracy of universal coordinated time, UTC. That is the international time maintained by BIPM in France. And every countries, most of the countries, developed countries, including India, actually maintains its own time with respect to UTC. Like for example, Indian standard time is 5.5 hours ahead of UTC. So it's UTC plus 5.5 hours. So what you see, so in this part until 1995, so the clocks were cesium beam clocks that was contributing to the UTC, and the accuracies become much better due to the insertion of the fountain clocks, laser cooled clocks. And you see that the it has the accuracies are increased further down today, and the UTC is maintained basically within less than sub-nanosecond accuracy. Okay, so this is one part. But then, as I said, exploring fundamental science, there 10 to the power minus 16 level clocks are not good enough. In fact, in the present scenario, the best clock available in the world are on the order of accuracy on the order of 10 to the power minus 9. And there also, it turns out, we need much better clock than 10 to the power minus 19. And the kind of fundamental science, as I already said, like looking into violations of the fundamental symmetries and looking into constancy of the fundamental constants. At the present scenario, we are trying, we are means worldwide, we are trying with clocks of 10 to the power minus 19. They give certain limits of the experiment, but not really the actual results, because to get the actual results, we need further better clocks. So this picture I already showed, like just to recap, give a recap. So these are these yellow and cyan ones are the optical clocks. And we have reached to a level of 10 to the power minus 19. They are very good clocks. They are very accurate. They are giving much, much better results than like few years before. But still, we need to improve further. So in the scientific part, what can be done using, let's say, these optical clocks, very accurate optical clocks. So this is the optical lattice clock. And this is the trapped ion clock. The principles, their principles, I already discussed yesterday. And as I already said, like those, the fundamental science experiments that are pursued by different advanced group in the world, they are like looking into constancy of fine structure constants or electron to proton mass ratio and so on. Looking into fundamental symmetries like Lorentz invariance violations, and so on, local position Lorentz invariance and temporal Lorentz invariance. Then geodic measurements, measuring the geode very accurately, which has a lot of, and I will discuss actually these first three things in my lecture today. Also looking into searching for dark matter, indirectly, the clocks are being used, and gravitational wave detections. There are also predictions that GW can be also detected using very accurate clocks. These are all in proposal stage at this moment. Quantum information processing uses optical clocks very, very, I mean, otherwise it will not work. Radio and optical astronomies, they use very accurate clocks, because just to give you a short example, like let's say we know about this next door GMRT, there are like 30 radio antennas distributed over several squares of kilometers. So all these antennas, they collect the signals from some observables. But if you do not time synchronize all these radio antennas, then you will not be able to find a correlation among the signals detected by different radio antennas. So their time synchronization among different radio antennas plays a major role. So they are very good, very accurate clocks are extremely important to make a sensible measurement. So to start with, let me give you the example of quantum communication. This is very active area in, let's say, last 5 years maybe, and all the developed countries they are working on that. Only few countries are able to show the quantum communication at present, and most of the countries are actually trying. So what it does, like, you, there are, like, let's say, two stations which are separated by thousands or few tens of thousand kilometers, like in two different continents. And one sends a encrypted signal. It's called quantum QKD, quantum key distribution, basically encrypted signal, encrypted in photons, some basis, like, let's say, polarization or something. And then it goes to satellite, then it reflects to the other side of in another continent, and then this guy has the key to decrypt that thing, and then he find out what is the actual data sent to him. Okay, I'm not going to detail of the technology, that's not the purpose of today's talk, but the point is, in this entire mechanism, very accurate time synchronization among all these three places, like the satellite, the launcher, and the receiver, plays a major role. Let's see how it does. So this is a cutout from one very good paper here from NICT Japan group, who have demonstrated the satellite-based quantum communication. And the picture, let's look into in detail. So these are the different let's say systems required to show the quantum communication, space-based quantum communication. So this part is the optical setup to prepare the photons at a particular polarization state, which is inside of a lab. And this is the some detailed optics. Then once the photons are prepared in a particular Hilbert space, what we call, or in a basis, then they are launched to the satellite. This is a microsatellite. It's orbiting at 600 kilometers from the Earth surface. So these photons are launched to the satellite. This is the launcher. And then these photons gets reflected from the satellites to the other side, where there is a receiver, right? And this is the details of the launcher. So now in all these three, in fact, four points, like here, 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 and on the other side, the time synchronization plays a major role. And this is what this paper actually says. Like, the signal that arrives at 1 meter telescope, that is this launcher, is extremely weak, with an average of 0.1 photons per receiver pulse. What does that mean? Like, let's say you send a photon pulse. It's not a continuous signal. You send a pulse of photons, but these photons are propagating through a like air medium and etc., going to the satellite. So they get dispersed due to the dust particles and etc., ionization and ionosphere and etc. So the photons actually reaches to the other end is very small in number. Most of it's a very lossy process. Most of it are getting lost. So in one pulse, on an average, you get 0.1 photons, which is like very, very, very small. So you need a very good detector at that point. Now NICT is that laboratory in Japan, develops the technology to perform the time synchronization and polarization reference frame matching between the satellites and the ground station directly from the QKD signal, as well as quantum receivers capable of detecting such a weak signal with low noise. So that's what I said, like, you need to develop a detector which has a very large efficiency of detecting photons, and you need a very good time synchronization. In order to realize quantum communication and quantum cryptography with such a weak signal, a key step is to accurate timestamp. So the signal what you are sending from this ground station to the satellites and then to the other side, you every time one has to give a time stamping. Like I am sending this signal at that time T1, you are receiving at a time T2, and then you can make a correlation measurements. I will come to that, what exactly it means in my next slide. Therefore, it is necessary to accurately synchronize the signals between, this is the actually the Socrates and the OGS ground station, optical ground station, to detect the transmitted bits without error. So there are two things. One is time stamp, another one is time synchronization. Like when you are sending the data or receiving data, you are giving a time tag to it, that is called time stamp. But these clocks at different places, like in ground station or anywhere else in the satellites, the clocks also need to be synchronized. Otherwise, the time stamp what you are giving, it's actually wrong time stamp. Yeah. So there are two different things. One is time stamp and time synchronization. So let's say how it, what exactly it means in a little bit more easier way. So these green things, green pulse, are like pulses of photons that one is sending from launcher to the satellites, and this this blue one is actually the photon distribution, the pulse of photons. So as I said, this is the signal what you are sending, but at the receiver end you are getting basically like this. This looks very much like noise. Yeah, this is like, because your signal to noise is very, very low, you are getting actually very, very less number of photons at the other end because of this dispersion. So what you have to do actually from the time stamping, like at exactly what time you are sending the signal and from what time you are receiving the signal, then you also know the photons are traveling at a speed of light. You know the position of these two receivers and the senders and the receiver, transmitter and the receiver. So from there you can calculate what is the time travel time for a photon from a particular point to another point. So counting that into your time total, like time stamping thing, you can say, okay, this is the photon what I was sending, and let's say corresponding to that this photon is here. So you can make a correlation measurement. Now see, the clocks cannot be absolutely accurate. Yeah, there is always some inaccuracy. This is what uncertainty principle says. Now, if you reduce your uncertainty, if you reduce your inaccuracy, so basically the point is, once you make more and more accurate clocks, you can your integration time of the signal can be shortened. And as your integration time can be shortened to establish the correlation, basically photons correlation, then you can send many more photons. So your bit rate, your data transmitting rate can be much faster. So that's actually the requirement. Like you can send some photons, you have a very weak signals at the other end, and then you are integrating it infinitely for long period of time to establish the correlation. The problem is only that you can send only few data per day probably, which is not useful. You have to send data very fast, like at a speed of, we typically use an internet speed of 100 Mbps and etc. I mean, even more than that. So if you want to increase your data sending rate, your integration time has to be shortened. And the only way is you have to establish the correlation in a very short period of time. And then there are two things which plays a role here. One is, like, instead of having, you have to develop a very good detectors, so your detection efficiency improves, as well as your time synchronization accuracies you improve, so that you can establish the correlation much faster. Okay, so this was one example. The next thing is like geodesy, some geodic measurement. Yeah, so in the second example, so in this picture what you see here, this blue one is the sea level, like let's say some typical sea level, and then this green one is the land. Yeah, so somewhere it is a hill, somewhere it is a down. So here you have an ocean because sea level is above the ground level, and etc. etc. And this magenta one is actually the geode. I hope you know what geode is. Geode is nothing but where Newtonian potential remains constant. Let's say for Earth, its Earth Newtonian potential will be constant on if you move over through this magenta line, for example. So that's called geode. Now you see, geode is also not just like a, I mean, it's varying, yeah, because there is a mass distribution on our Earth that makes the geode to be varied. Now, if you, let's say, take a clock here on top of the hill, and if you take a clock here on, let's say, around at the sea level, the tick rates of the clock, well, here I'm talking about accurate clocks, not a simple like our wristwatch. Yeah, the tick rates will be different. And the difference will be because this is due to the change of the geopotential at this point compared to at this point. And the way the geopotential change, delta U, with respect to height is the difference between these two points, is following like this. This can be this capital G is the constant, ME is mass of the Earth, H is the height difference, and RE is the radius of Earth. So if you just solved it, typically it comes, I mean, approximately it comes like this. And if you put the values for all these constant terms, then you get delta U is 0.1 times H over 1 centimeter in a unit of meter square per second square. Now the fractional accuracy of a clock, delta F by F0 that I introduced yesterday, is equals to it changes with respect to height on Earth is following delta U divided by C square. So as I said, the tick rates will be different here compared to what is here. And the difference of tick rates is basically what it says here in this formula. Okay. Now, if you put all the numbers, you get this delta F over F0 approximately 10 to the power minus 8 times minus 18 times H. Yeah. So if you take a clock which has fractional accuracy, let's say delta F over F0 is 10 to the power minus 16, which is a fountain clock, then you can resolve H at a level of 100 centimeter. So that means, like, if you take a clock, let's say at some point here, and if you put at some other height at 100 centimeter, you will not be able to look into the change of tick rates if you have a clock which has a fractional accuracy 10 to the power minus 16. And if you remember, that is a fountain clock. So just changing the height by 100 centimeter using a very accurate fountain clock, you will not be able to resolve 100 centimeter. Better than 100, more than 100 centimeter you have to do. Whereas if you take a optical clocks, then delta F over F0 is 10 to the power minus 18. So there, this H reduces by two orders of magnitude. So you can discriminate only 1 centimeter. So what does that mean? That basically means, if you want to detect this geode, this magenta line, which is very important in geology and also in many other places, geode plays major role because how the Earth surface is changing, the mass distribution is Earth is changing. I'll come to that in my next slide. So that is actually detected by change of geode. So in geology, it plays a major role. So there, by using an optical clock, one can determine change of geode within a level of 1 centimeter accuracy, whereas by using a fountain clock, it can be detected by 100 centimeter accuracy. So there is lot of improvement. And that's why one of the reasons why people want to do a optical clock. So by the way, one thing, so typically these optical clock technology is very, very complicated. So these are developed inside of a lab, inside of a very well-equipped optical laboratory. As you can see it here, this is one example from a PTB Germany. But if you want to transport this clock, let's say on top of this hill, so you have to miniaturize everything. Yeah, you cannot take the entire laboratory on top of the hill and then next day again come back. That's not possible. So that's why there is a major advance in that field to develop a transportable optical clock, and that's the picture you see here that is also developed by PTB Germany. So that's just developed on a truck, and then this truck can go anywhere, like on top of the hill. So maybe in next few years it will be developed so that the drone can take it, but I mean it's not yet developed at this moment, but I'm just saying, like, transportable optical clock development is very important to do this kind of experiment, and people are already doing it. So why geode measurement is very important? Let's say there is a volcanic, so I kept everywhere the references. So if anyone wants to read further, they can go to the references. Like, for example, the reference is given here. So what I was saying, like, let's say there is a volcano. So this is the reservoir for this magma. And let's say for this volcanic eruption, this magma comes out and then gets distributed over some space around this volcano. Yeah, then this reservoir gets a little bit empty. Yeah, but what happens by due to this volcanic eruption, the geode will change its architecture. Yeah. So, and we have learned that it changes accordingly, where delta M is the change of mass. In this case, like this magma came out and got redistributed. And this R and D is basically these two distances from the center of this reservoir. So you can see what you can determine, what is the change of delta U, the Newtonian potential or geode potential, by having a very accurate clocks. And this is one of the example why accurate development of the highly accurate optical clock plays a major role. And what it changes, because it changes the rotation of Earth, the direction as well as the speed slightly. And that can be determined by exact determination of this delta U. Okay. The other applications of it is like looking into mapping the, let's say there are some this hydrocarbon reservoir, like let's say petroleum or natural gas or similar kind of things under the earth or under the sea level. That can be also detected by using very accurate clocks. How it does, like let's say this is a ship, it has a transmitter, so it transmits a signal, a sound wave, and while transmitting it gives a time tag, time stamp. And then there are lots of receivers distributed over the sea surfaces, and then this sound wave gets reflected from the bottom of the ocean floor, from the ocean floor, and then they get reflected to these receivers, and this receiver detects this signal, and when it receives, it again gives a timestamp. But this sound wave will take different amount of time, even if they are, let's say, their path length is same. It will take different amount of time to receive to this receiver because of the density difference of this hydrocarbon reservoir. When it passes through the hydrocarbon reservoir, if the density is different at two different places, it will take different amount of time to reach to the receiver. And by using that data and together with correct models, one predicts whether there is a hydrocarbon reservoir or not. And that is actually the technique how petroleums and natural gases are found. For example, this is the water level under our own country that was determined by this kind of technologies. And that can be detected very accurately if you have more accurate clocks and better models. Yeah. So now I'm coming to the third example, which is like, let's say, looking into the violation of fundamental symmetries, in this case, local Lorentz invariance, LLI. So the picture what you see is the cosmic microwave background at different times. It was like kind of estimated with higher and higher resolutions. But I'm not going to talk about the cosmic microwave background today. That's not the topic of my discussion. But the cosmic microwave background is actually a rest frame for our universe. That frame is not changing with time. That's what is considered. So now the Lorentz invariance says basically any laws of physics that will be independent of the orientation of the reference frame, right? So if we consider this cosmic microwave background as a constant, as a fixed reference frame, and then if we do an experiment where the reference frame of the laboratory will change with respect to this CMB, then it should give a different results in case the Lorentz symmetry violates, right? If it doesn't violate, then the results would be identical, right? So that is actually these experimental proposals were given in 2002, where it was the proposal was like put clocks at different places on Earth and also in different spaces on places on space, like in this case, like international space stations, in satellites, in different parts of the world, and this has to be very accurate clocks. And you can understand this is not an easy experiment. Like, first of all, making an optical clock at different places, it's already, I mean, only there are a few places, 4 or 5 places in the world who have this kind of accurate optical clocks. Then making it space compatible to put them in space, it will take another some more time to do that things. Yeah, so this is only a proposal at this moment. The way how it will work, the change of Hamiltonian or the perturbation of the energy state in this case is equals to some C0 matrix elements, and then U is the Newtonian potential. So as the potential changes, the tick rates of the clock will change, that I already described in my previous slides. And this third part is actually dependent on local Lorentz invariance. So C0 is a tensor which depends on the relative change of the reference frame. Like, for example, let's say the relative change of clock's reference frame with respect to CME reference frame. Yeah, so this is a tensor, so it has like all kind of components into it. And T0 is the quadruple moment operator of the electronic momentum distribution. So the so this is sensitive to the quadruple moment of the electronic distribution. So electron distribution in different states has many higher order poles, and quadrupole is one of those things. So if you that I'll come later on in the next slide. Okay, so this experiment is really not possible at the present scenario, because we don't have, like, in the world, nobody have clocks, optical clocks that can be kept into the space stations or in the satellites. But maybe in 10 years from now that will happen. But what has happened already? Oh, by the way, yeah. So in this case, yttrium ion, there are several candidates for the clocks which have some sensitivity to this to the this T0 matrix element, T02 matrix element. And this is like different ions, calcium ion, barium ion, yttrium ion, and yttrium ion has three clock transitions. Out of that, the octupole transition, which we call, this is the F7½ state, that has the highest sensitivity or highest rate of like this T02 matrix elements has highest sensitivity for that state. So yttrium ion clock is a very good clock to do this kind of experiment. Yeah, so what I was saying, a miniaturized version, or a, let's say, first version of this entire experiment is already done and reported in last week, last year, sorry. And this is the experiment done at PTB in Germany. So this is what you see in this picture. This is the CMB, cosmic microwave background, whose frame of reference is fixed. And then in their laboratory in PTB, they developed two yttrium ion clocks at the octupole transition, which has highest sensitivity. So this is clock's reference frame one. This is the second clock, which has a different reference frame. So the direction of this magnetic field, this red arrow, that shows what is the orientation of that clock's reference frame. So if you apply a particular magnetic field along a particular direction, that means you are quantizing axis to that particular direction. So if you apply two different magnetic fields for two independent clocks, that means you have two different quantization direction, and that's what it says basically. So in this case, B is along this direction. In this case, B is along this direction. These are two different clocks measuring exactly same clock transition. So identically, the clock frequency, clock tick rates has to be exactly same, because these are the same transitions. Well, of course, within its accuracy. Now, what happened? Like, Earth rotates, yeah, around its axis. So that means, so the rotation of Earth is basically change of laboratory's own reference frame with respect to the CMB reference frame over one day. Now, if you compare the clock transition, measured clock transition by these two atomic clocks, very highly sensitive atomic clocks, if Lorentz invariance is invariant, it doesn't violate, then this change of clock tick rates will be zero. But if it is different, like if the Lorentz symmetry violates, then these tick rates for two different clocks will be changing, right? So that was the experiment. And it was done. And so basically what it means that the C0 coefficient for each clocks will vary differently over one day because they are rotating over this fixed reference frame in case Lorentz symmetry violates. And that experiment was done, and these are the different values of this C0 matrix element components. And these are actually not values, these are the higher limits. So this is the sensitivity level that these experiments have reached. So that doesn't say that Lorentz invariance is actually violated or not. This experiment is actually called null experiment, like zero result. So they cannot say that whether Lorentz symmetry violates or not, but they can only say that what are the sensitivity of their experiment to measure Lorentz symmetry violations. And this is not the only experiment. There are several other experiments completely different way. Like, for example, this is a calcium ion optical clock transition. This is a dysphorium atom measuring some microwave transition. And these are like astronomical data from some quasar observations data and etc. looking into redshift and etc. So you can see these are different, completely different experiments, and all of them are actually null experiment. None of them says whether Lorentz symmetry violates are or not, but they only give whether what is the level of accuracy that they have reached to. But what you can see here, the optical clock comparison is orders of magnitude better compared to, let's say, astrophysics data or the other two experiments. Like these are on the order of 10 to the minus 20, whereas these are on the order of 10 to the minus 15, 10 to the minus 17, 10 to the minus 18. So the point is optical clock comparison is a tabletop experiment, but it can give much, much better accuracy compared to, for example, astronomical observations. And the reason is actually, like when you do the astronomical observations, then you measure the redshifts. But how accurately can you measure the redshift? It's first of all coming from some an infinitely long, source, which is at infinitely cosmological scale, which is much away from, you don't know how, it's a very low, and then the actual redshift calculation is very difficult. So the limit, what you can, how accurately you can calculate the redshift, that gives you these limitations. So if you can improve the limits of your redshift calculation, you can even also get improvement here. And many works are also going on that direction. The third example is the looking into constancy of the fundamental constants. Like in this case, I will discuss about the constancy of fine structure constant, whether it is varying over cosmic time or not. So this was first paper was written in 1967 by a group in Caltech, and this is, it's only one page PRL paper. Yeah, so they like proposed that this may vary for these reasons. This is only one page, very nice PRL paper, just written very short, and this question, exactly this question was raised. Then in 1999, Australian group, they theoretically estimated that by looking into quasar absorption spectra, one can predict whether fine structure constant is really varying or not varying. And in the same year, from the same division actually, some experimental observations also came from the quasar absorption spectra by calculating the redshift of the quasar absorption spectra. So from 1999 until recently, like 2004. So this is the prediction of alpha variation. Well, again, this is only the limit. It's not really the value of alpha variation, but these are like limits of their experiment. So from then to 2014, by looking into optical clock comparisons, you see that the accuracies have improved by two orders of magnitude. This is, both are in 10 to the minus 16 scale, but it's 2.2 and this is 0.07. So it's almost 30 times improvement in accuracy. But yet nobody found anything variation of alpha or not. It's only like their experimental sensitivity. So why alpha should vary? There are different theories and models, and it's not possible for me today to go into all different models, and it's in fact it's not possible by one single person probably, but I will try to give a simple argument that why alpha can vary or whether it can vary or not. Yeah, this for me this looks like easier to understand that why alpha should vary or should not vary. So the alpha, we know from our childhood that we read that alpha is equals to 1 over 1, but it's actually since it's a constant from the co-data, it has with the value, exact value have been given like this. It's like several digits, 6 digits, 9 digits after the decimal points. Very accurately it has been measured. But the question is whether even this number is a constant or it is varying with time. So the alpha can be written in SI unit, can be written as E square over 4 pi epsilon naught. Epsilon naught is the permittivity, and 1 over h bar times c. H bar is the Planck's constant and c is the velocity of light. So this entire thing is dimensionless. So this quantity, first quantity is energy times distance, and the second quantity is 1 over energy times distance. So in altogether it's a dimensionless quantity. But you see, this part is also constant and this part is also constant. Planck's constant is a constant, c is a constant, and everything else is a constant. So let's take this part, h bar times c. This is a constant, and that can be written in terms of electric charge, phi zero. Phi zero is the magnetic flux due to spinning of an electron. So it's a quantized magnetic flux due to one single electron, and square root of permittivity and permeability. And this can be written like that, where phi m is related to phi zero. So it's an energy related to the magnetic flux, and phi e is energy related to the electric flux of a spinning electron. So now if you take a relative derivative of these things, then you can get a constant times delta phi e over phi e plus delta phi m over phi m. This is the standard of what we do for our error analysis and so on. So now if this quantity is similarly, you can do it for the other part, like this epsilon e square divided by 4 pi epsilon zero. This is also a constant. And similarly, you can write this entire alpha in terms of square root of phi e over phi m, like what we have written here. Now, if you take a derivative of alpha, like this entire quantity, then you get a negative sign here. So just the discrepancy is here, it's a positive sign. And here it's a negative sign. And these constants are also two different constants. It's not the same constant. Now there are possibility one, like if you take this h bar times c is not changing. So that means this quantity is zero. So if you take zero, then this entire quantity is zero. And that basically says it's conservation of the electromagnetic energy, because this part is electric energy, this is the magnetic energy. So this total is electromagnetic energy related to a single electron, spinning of a single electron. So if you consider that the electron's energy is conserved, which probably makes sense to consider, then you get this relation. So that means delta alpha by alpha will not be a constant, because you can insert these relations here, then it will be a non-zero quantity. So delta alpha by alpha will be a non-zero. However, the other possibility is like you consider this part is zero. Delta alpha by alpha is a dimensionless fundamental constant. So you consider that part is zero. Then you have another problem, like total electromagnetic energy of an electron is not constant. So where that extra energy is coming from? So major question. So this is the discrepancy in our, let's say, standard model of physics. Which one is correct? In our standard model, alpha is a constant. In our standard model, energy conservation also holds quite very good. So there is a openness in our standard model, and that's why people are so much interested to find out what actually is happening. Now, why in case if you consider alpha is a constant or not constant, then if the electromagnetic energy has to change, why it should change? Then there are different models also, like the model basically comes from dark matter and dark energy, and that is not possible to cover what are those models and how it is related in this lecture, because this could be a complete separate lectures by someone else. But basically it relates to the dark matter, dark energy, and also there are explanations to the quantum electrodynamic model. Like, we know that in the quantum electrodynamics, the vacuum is not really a vacuum, but it is polarized. The vacuum breaks into electron positron pair, and then again this electron positron recombines. There are reasons why it breaks into electron positron pair and why it again recombines, but these are like theoretical models. Also, we know in general relativity that equivalence principle holds very good, but whether if it violates or not due to some like ghost quantum field and etc., that could be also another possible model why the fine structure constant should violate or should not violate. So anyhow, that's not part of my today's lecture. So the point is, we want to measure whether alpha is varying or not using very accurate optical clocks, and then to get an answer whether fundamental symmetries, which are related to standard model of our physics, are really symmetric or it violates, or constancy of the fundamental constant, which is given by general theory of relativity, are really constant or varying with time and etc., etc. And if we can find these answers, this actually probably answers many different things, and it probably takes us towards the grand unification of the standard model. We know in our standard model the gravity is not yet included. Gravitational force cannot be explained by the standard model. So maybe that will, this is not only one experiment, but this is one of the experiments which can give us a good answer whether grand unification is possible or not possible. And since this is very much interesting, there are not only one experiment, like let's say optical clock comparison, which looks towards constancy of the alpha, fine structure constant, but there are several of them. For example, these are the most recent experimental results by looking into comparison of clock transitions in different type of clocks, like ytterbium ion octupole transition, ytterbium ion dipole quadrupole transition, and compare them as I was describing in few slides earlier for local Lorentz symmetry violation. It's very much similar to that, and different other clocks, and the results are on the order of 10 to the minus 18. You can see 10 to the minus 16, but it's at 0.0.07, so it's on the order of 10 to the minus 17. So these are again experimental limit, not exactly giving any value of alpha variation, but it's giving their experimental sensitivity of their experiment. This is the experiment, same like looking into alpha variation by looking into redshift of quasar absorption spectra. So this is in radio frequency domain by looking into hyperfine the radio frequency transitions between hyperfine levels. And this is, by the way, from both of these authors are very close to us. Like, this is from Nisim Kanekar from our NCRA, and this is our own Sri Anand who got these two data from quasar absorption spectra, and these are very marvelous paper actually. Then also delta alpha by alpha have been looked through the change of nuclear reactions. Like in Oklo in Gabon, it's in South Africa, there is a natural uranium reactor. It's a natural reactor, not a man-made reactor. So it's running for 2 billions of years. Yeah. And there is a discrepancy of nuclear decay rate. What it's supposed to be, there is a discrepancy of that. And by looking into that discrepancy, also delta alpha by alpha can be modeled or estimated, and that has also been estimated. So it's a completely different type of experiment. See, all experiments are completely different experiments through completely different paths. This is like looking into a very sensitive microwave transitions in dysphorium, and there are also other possible experiments which have been proposed through astronomical observations and etc. what you see here, so these are like values of the experimental sensitivity that they have reached, and out of them optical clock is like at least one order of magnitude better, more sensitive compared to any other experiments like here. So what next? I mean, we have developed very accurate clocks. Maybe it is possible to develop further accurate clocks, but it's very difficult. So the next thing is actually networking among the experiments. For example, here, this is like looking into different UV telescopes. So these are the very, very large telescopes, plus Keck, plus Subaru. Okay, by the way, this is not really my field, but I'm just saying. These are different telescopes looking into all these telescopes are looking into same quasar absorption spectra, and then they intercompare. So then what happens? Their experimental sensitivity becomes much higher. Instead of one experiment, you connect several same similar experiments together to reduce your uncertainties, particularly the statistical uncertainty and etc. So that, and also systematic uncertainty to a certain level. So then you can improve your experimental sensitivity, and that was is happening. This is again a paper where Sri Anand is an author, and the next generation, they want to go even further, higher accurate detections, and this is a proposal which is in archive at this moment. Similarly, for the optical clocks also, now what is happening, different optical clocks in different continents. For example, this is in UK, this is in Germany, in PTB, and this is in France, in Sierre. They are connecting all these optical clocks together using optical fibers, which is growing actually under the sea. This is the English Channel, by the way. So it's going under the sea, and they are connecting all the optical clocks together to improve their sensitivity. Yeah, that's what is happening. And so I think I would skip that part a little bit. So the next thing is basically what we understood, like connecting different experiments together. Otherwise, a significant improvement into the present sensitivity is not possible, because you cannot build, I mean, you, over the night or over, let's say, a couple of years, you cannot build an optical clock or any other kind of clock which is, let's say, 2 to 3 orders of magnitude higher sensitivity, which may come later on, like after 10 years and so on, but immediately it's not possible. Immediately what is possible, connecting different experiments together, and that's what people are trying. These are few examples of different experiments, not looking into alpha variation, but any different experiment, they are actually connecting experiment together. For example, here, these are cesium microwave clocks, which maintains the UTC, universal coordinated time, and there are almost 350 atomic clocks throughout the world, including in India. They are connected together and maintaining the UTC at BIPM in France. This is the VLBI, very large baseline array, different radio telescopes throughout the world. They are connected together. And they are, by the way, time synchronization also plays a role, otherwise it would not work. So any experiment which connects together different experimental setups, here time synchronization plays a very important role. This is like this event horizon telescope. So part of this VLBI, they participate in to make this event horizon telescopes. They are connected together. Here, what you see, different LIGO, different gravitational wave detectors, like 2 LIGO, Virgo, Kagra, they are all connecting together to look into the same gravitational wave, and et cetera. Similarly, for the optical clocks also, throughout, there are different optical clocks in world, and that these red dots, they are showing different optical clocks in different parts of the world. These are in US and Canada. This is in European Union countries. This is in Japan, and one is in China. And the next generation will be connecting together. And already there is work going on. For example, this European Union, within the European Union, several optical clocks, as I already described, that in NPL UK, PTB in Germany, and Sierre in France, and Italy in INRIM, they are connected together through these optical fiber networks. In China, they are coming up very fast. They are connecting their optical clocks together through the optical fiber. So that would be the next thing which will probably happen in next couple of years. And the ways to connect, I mean, these are the different fiber connections. like this is European Union fiber connection, this is at USA and several others, which is not just putting a fiber. You have to do a lot more than that. You have to stabilize this fiber to reach to that sensitivity level. That itself is a very complicated work, but these things are already going on. So in last two slides, so here I am actually setting up myself, I am setting up a laboratory in Iuka, which is called Precision and Quantum Measurement Lab. And I want to, my main focus would be to look into this kind of fundamental physics by using optical clocks. So I will develop my plan is to develop an ytterbium ion optical clock to probe its octopole transition, and then using that for quantum metrology, precision measurement, and also to support quantum information processing. So this is the detailed of it. So heart of it is obviously the optical clock, ytterbium ion optical clock. Then we also need microwave clocks, which will be commercialized, but this will be developed here. And then a reference cavity to make everything stable. And finally, once you have this ultra-stable, ultra-narrow line with photons, that can be disseminated to different experiment to do the actual physics experiment. And for that, you need this phase-stabilized fiber, what I just discussed. So initially, it will be done in a smaller scale before it's going to the larger scales. And this is actually part of the India's quantum mission. I don't know whether you have heard of that, that in the last, this year's union budget, the quantum mission was getting 8,000 crore for different kind of experiment to start this kind of experiments in India. And it has four verticals. First vertical is quantum sensor and metrology. So all the experiments in PQM lab at Iuka is related to this quantum metrology. So we are part of that. Okay, so I am done. So now I can take the questions. Are there questions?
I think so. No one has a question.
Huh?
No one has a question. No one has raised the hand or not. No.
Okay. Okay.
Chat also. Please raise your hand if you have any questions, or just type in the chat box to the Shubhadeep Tay.
Yeah. Somebody raised their hand.
Yeah. So I'm just unmuting Sain Gupta. Yeah. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Sir, the atomic clocks, how are they specializing our dark matter detection and in the dark matter portion? Can you please elaborate on that part a bit?
See, atomic clock is not detecting the dark matter directly. See, dark matter, never said in my talk that atomic clock is detecting the dark matter. But if there is a dark matter, yeah, that will give you the expansion of the universe and or acceleration of the universe, and that will cause change of alpha over time. So using the atomic clock, we are actually detecting change of alpha, d alpha by dt, time dependency of alpha. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. I do not see any questions in the YouTube also. Is there anyone who is taking care of YouTube thing?
Yeah, I'm taking just okay. Looking at that document also, but no one has updated okay. That document.
Okay.
So let's see if we can get the question later on, we can just respond to them.
Yeah.
Okay. In case we can end the lecture as there is no other questions.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe.